Welcome to South Fork Country Church. Glad you joined us today, here and online.
Our call to worship this morning will be, "He touched me." You can sit or you can stand. I'm not on any kind of formal because I'm sitting.
Ready?
Sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Now, prayer letters. We have prayer letters in the back of the auditorium here. If you care, take some time, sign them. People appreciate them. Bulletin, printed tabs. Zoom. We have our midweek Zoom Bible study. If you could join us, it's a pretty good crew there with that. That's at 6 p.m. on weekdays. Wednesdays. I'm sorry. It's weekday. It's a Wednesday. Okay. Wow. Upcoming South Fork Country Church events. I'll tell you what, I can't even see that. I'm sorry.
Okay, I can. Murphy Mays Days. We will be participating in this event in Murphy, Texas. We can be found at Booth 60. We hope to see you there. If you would like to volunteer to man the booth for an hour or so, please contact Sarah Houston or Sheila Wilkinson. No, after today's service. I think it should be now after today's service. If South Fork Country Church crafting activities, Carolyn Rockefeller will be leading us in creating a floral arrangement and glassware redesign. Please join us for an afternoon of fun. The sign-up sheet is on the table next to the prayer letters. Mr. Tom?
As we prepare for a time of prayer today, I'd like for us to remember, of course, Brother Bobby, who's unable to be with us today. He is staying away out of a great amount of caution. There's no illness concern at this point, but do remember Brother Bobby in your prayers, Sister Susan, as well. Do we have other prayer requests this morning that we'd like to bring forward, or maybe a praise? I believe Brother Bobby normally asks for it this time. Yes.
My daughter and son-in-law were traveling between West Point and South Carolina.
Okay.
Traveling Mercies,
traveling between West Point and where was that in South Carolina?
Myrtle
in
Beach.
South Carolina. All righty. Also, sir?
Yes. I have a friend named Jack, and he's quite the guy, and he's been in the place, did everything, but he's been terminal for some time.
Okay.
Got the same COPD and found out he now has lung cancer.
Ooh. Praise the Lord.
Yes,
we'll be talking a little bit about that personal reaching out to people in the day's service today as well. Yes.
I have two different friends. Joe is having surgery on her hip tomorrow, and I just wanted to ask her to pray for Joe.
Okay. Okay, remember these two prayer requests, and of course,
Tom?
Yes.
Nancy's sister who passed away a couple of weeks ago, their service is this Sunday or today.
Okay.
At Spicewood Beach, and I just want to remember.
Certainly remember this family in your prayers.
The Steele family, her name was Ruth Ann Steele.
Okay, remember the Steele family in your prayers, Nancy, of course, as well. And I asked you to remind me earlier, and of course, I forgot between there and here. Hopewell. Do you remember the Hopewell Missionary Baptist Church? It's north and east of here. Clarksville, Texas. The pastor's wife and also one of their deacons recently passed away from COVID, and that church is going through a time of recentering and growth together, but do be in prayer for them as well. Let's go to the Lord in word of prayer. Of course, if you have other prayer requests or even these prayer requests, make sure you put them on the tab on your bulletin. Put them in the offering plate. And that way they can be spread amongst church leadership. Our Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, praise you for this time to worship together. We thank you, Lord, for the many brothers and sisters who are here in the congregation as well as those who are joining us over the internet. We ask you now, Lord, to be in this service. May your spirit be among us, and may your spirit guide us through our daily lives in such a way that we can be able to be a light to the community around us. And Lord, give us a time of fellowship today so that we can say that truly it has been good to be in the house of the Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to continue here with, I'm going to guess, a song about as old as I am, and I ain't going to tell you how old I am. but it's talking about a railroad, and basically that's what our journey is. We're just like this, like a railroad, up the hills, down the hills, through the valleys, through the tunnels, through hard times, through good times, so forth and so on. Are you ready, Mr. Ross?
I'm ready. life is like a mountain railroad with an endless train. We must make the one successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves, the fields of tunnels never falter, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your eye upon the rail. You will roll up range of trials, you will cross the bridge of strife. See that
next song. Golly, I don't remember the first time I done it here, but I was asked to do this by members I know that are home watching, which is Charles and Ann Porter. This is one of Charles's favorite songs. So, Charlie, here you go, and hopefully I remember it well enough not to butcher it. You ready?
Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus. cheer up my brother, live in the sunshine, we'll understand it all by and by.
When we see Jesus coming in glory, when he comes down his home in the sky, then we shall
filling in for Susan, who would be talking to you today about the Mary Hill Davis offerings. Today we're going to see a video about the River Ministries at the South Texas border.
Ayuda espiritualmente y por eso the missions groups that come down and serve our communities. They come alongside our churches. We've been hearing a lot about what's been going on at the river, so we decided that we would come to see for ourselves what was really going on. We had vacation Bible school material, we had Bibles, we had coloring books. We needed more things. We didn't have nearly enough to be able to provide for all the needs there. It was so great because here were these grown men sitting there reading the material that we had handed out to them. And the kids were looking at the material that we had given them. And, you know, that was our prayer, that God would take whatever we took and use it. And that's what happened. And with the Miriam Davis offering for the state, it's a huge contributing factor to the success of all the ministries that are going on here. And without that, it would be even harder to meet the needs of the people that are here.
It doesn't have to be an overseas mission trip. You can do God's work here in the backyard of Texas and experience that. And what God wants to do through you and see how you can impact other families through your God-given gifts. You can pray, you can go, or you can give.
Thank you, Texas Baptist, for giving the Miriam Davis offering to support Texas Missions.
I am Texas Missions.
I am Texas Missions.
We are all Texas Missions.
So when you give $15, as you can see on the slide, they can provide soccer balls to share with the gospel in the sports camp. $100 provides seeds for four community gardens along the border. The prayers are needed, overwhelmed, and they are because of the increase with COVID-19. Please pray for all missionaries serving in the medical missions and for the additional volunteers and ministries and partners. So thank you on behalf of Susan and the Texas Missions, and may God bless you and your prayers and gifts to the Texas Mission.
Whoops. There is no room for whoopses this morning. We are the fill-ins.
Like the replacements?
Yeah, exactly. We are allowed. I mean, I should have already been up here ready to say that the church does encourage you, South Fork Missionary, South Fork Church does encourage you. I've been in enough churches over the years that I automatically just throw the word missionary in there. I don't know. Anyway, give. You can give through email. You can give through going online to the church website. You can give in the plates that are off to the left. Once again, out of abundance of caution, we won't be passing plates around, but we do encourage you to give, and we do thank you for all your gifts and being a part of this ministry. So thank you very much, and your gifts go towards helping out with our mission efforts that we do. It goes towards the benevolence offering that we saw last week with the local VA representative, and goes towards the support and ongoing ministry of South Fork Church. So thank you very much.
This next song, that first time I heard it was 1960. And by the way, I still have the album that the song was on. The Gunfighter album, Marty Robbins, the big purple, and not purple, but whatever color it was. Anyhow, the point of it is, it's the master's call. And once you've heard it, you ain't never the same. So, here we go. When I was but a young man, I was wild and full of fire. Youth within my teens, but full of challenge and desire. Ran away from home and left my mother and my dad. I know it grieved them so to think their only boy was bad. I fell in with an outlaw band, their names you know quite well. How many times we've robbed and plundered, I could never tell. This kind of sinful living leads only to a will fall. I learned that much and more the night I heard my master call. One night we rustled cattle, 1,000 head or so, and started them out on the trail that leads to Mexico. When a northern started blowing, lightning flashed above, I thought someone was calling me, I thought I heard a shout. And at that moment lightning struck not 20 yards from me, and left there was a giant cross, but once there had been a tree. This time I knew I'd heard a voice, voice so sweet and strange, a voice that came from everywhere, a voice that called my name. So frightened I was thinking of sinful deeds I'd done, I failed to see 1,000 head of cattle start to run. The cattle they stampeded were roaring all around. My pony ran but stumbled and he threw me to the ground. I felt the end was nearing, that death would be the price, when a mighty bolt of lightning showed the face of Jesus Christ. And I cried, oh Lord, forgive me, don't let it happen now. I want to live for you alone, oh God, these words I vow. My wicked past unfolded, I thought of wasted years, when another bolt of lightning killed 100 head of steers, and the others rushed on by me, but I was left to live. The master had a reason, his is still to let him give. A miracle performed that night, I wasn't meant to die. The dead ones formed a barricade, at least 6 or 7 high, and right behind him there was I, afraid but safe and sound. I cried and begged for mercy, then and there upon the ground. A pardon I was granted, my sinful soul set free, no more to wear the angry waves upon life's stormy seas. Forgiven by the love of God, a love that will remain, I gave my life and soul the night the Savior called my name.
Your turn.
By the way, I said they could give by email. I don't even know how you give by email. I meant postal mail. It's some mail. I got close. You know, I was actually talking to them back there before all this. I said, you know, my sermons go through 3 stages. I start with a verse or a selection of verses, and then I work through the points, and then I go back and trim back all the extra. I only got through two steps this time, so y'all might get a little extra this morning.
Good.
We will see. I'm going to be in the book of Hebrews, by the way, if y'all want to head over that way. Right there near the end of it. There are a lot of books in the Bible that people would typically say were their favorite. I mean, how do you choose? It's like, which is your favorite child? Parents never answer that question. Although I will say that in one graduation, my wife started out her parent blessing by giving the name of the child and saying, "You are my favorite graduating senior." The ears of every one of her siblings perked up in the entire auditorium the moment she said, "You are my favorite." So how do you choose a favorite out of all the places in Scripture you could go? Got allergies going on this morning. And Hebrews has always sort of held that place for me. Some people would say the gospel, some people would say Romans. The first chapter of the book of John is also one of my favorites. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But the book of Hebrews goes through so many things, and they tie together. And this morning we're going to be looking in the last chapter of the book of Hebrews, and we're going to sort of be tying up all the loose ends that were left throughout the book. You know, Hebrews chapter 7 talks about something, and my wife is going to give me a look as soon as I say this name, Melchizedek, because she has heard me preach on this one individual who's mentioned in like two verses in the Old Testament and 10 verses in the New Testament, and that's it. You just don't hear about this individual called Melchizedek. But the truth that we get from Melchizedek is so deep. That's Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 11, the great faith chapter. Of course, the last verse of Hebrews chapter 10 starts off with, "Now the just shall live by faith." The Bible doesn't repeat itself very often, but it repeats itself three times on that. The Bible says three times that the just will live by faith. And then chapter 11, the great faith chapter, that lists all the heroes of the faith and then says all of these were unable to experience what we could experience because they came before the time of Christ. Chapter 12, we're reminded to lay aside the weight and the sin that does so easily beset us. Chapter 4 has a treatise on rest. Man, there are days when I could use a good rest. And then I remember my honey-do list. But we're introduced to Christ in chapter 4 in a very special way. We're introduced to Christ who is tempted in every way that we are, yet without sin. By the way, my opinion, three of the most important words in the entire Bible. To introduce Christ to us and then say, he lived as we do, with one exception, yet without sin. And then we get to chapter 13, and I'm going to bounce around a little bit in chapter 13 today. I'm going to begin in verse 9. Is a good place to begin. I'm also going to bounce around probably a little bit in Bible versions. I typically, for many years, have preached out of the venerable King James Version of the Bible, but this morning we're going to start off at the NIV, where the Bible says in verse 9, "Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have the right to eat." We have here an exhortation to remain true to the teachings that we have been given, not to be carried away by all sorts of strange teachings. I want you to understand for a minute the audience that this is being aimed at. The audience that this is being aimed at are Jewish people. This is the book of Hebrews. And we have to recall that. This is a group of people who have taken the message and the instructions given in the Old Testament and have built out volumes of definitions to make sure that people do things exactly the way they're supposed to do them. If the Old Testament said that you weren't supposed to walk too far on the Sabbath, they figured out exactly how many steps that was. If you weren't supposed to harvest, they figured out exactly what harvest meant. If you weren't supposed to prepare food, they came with definitions that showed exactly what each of these things meant. And they were over and above what was given in the Scriptures. That's why Christ spent so much time looking at the Pharisees and just using one word to describe them. He said, "You are hypocrites." And so because of that, there have been so many strange teachings that have been added to the Word of God that we're giving an exhortation. Exhortation means to lift someone up and instruct. An exhortation to not follow after strange teachings. In the King James Version, the word for strange is divers. Divers teachings. I was like, when I first read through this, I was like, what is that, scuba? But the word divers is more like the word diverse. It means a motley collection of teachings. Do not be led away or led in the wrong direction by this, because I will give you a biblical truth in this. If you take a whole lot of right and you add a little bit of wrong, it all becomes wrong. There is no such thing as watered down truth in the Bible. There is truth and there is false. And I know in a day where everything seems to be multiple shades of gray and multiple shades of everything, where people want to be able to say, well, that's a little wrong and that's a little right. And, you know, for me to say that there is just black and white and things are like that is a difficult thing to say. But let me explain something to you. When the day comes, I'll turn sideways. I got good at this as a preacher back in the day. I used to leave half the audience. You'll get where I'm going. Turn sideways. We'll just let the choir be the bad guys, right? When the day comes and there's a line going to heaven and a line going to hell, no choir up there, so yeah, did good. There's not going to be an in-between line where you get to visit back and forth a couple times a week. You're not going to have joint custody between heaven and hell. You're going to be in one or the other. There is no in between. You have either accepted Christ as your Savior or you have not. Being careful, love. I almost went down another rabbit trail. Man, I love that rabbit trail, but we'll have to see about that one later on, maybe some other time. Teachings can enter any religion and become a tradition. And really what we're getting at here in the book of Hebrews is almost a explanation against the concept of religion. And you're like, but Brother Brown, you're in a church, you've been Baptist most of your life, you're in a country church today, and isn't that a religion? No, that's a group of believers meeting together to worship God and to teach others about Christ. That is an assembly. That's what church means. What I'm talking about is religion. Religion is when you take that assembly and begin layering on top of it a bunch of traditions that may or may not have anything to do with the kingdom of God. This is what they had in the time of Christ. They had traditions layered upon on top of each other, layer upon layer upon layer of tradition that had become a religion, that had become a way of life that no one could ever meet. So think about these verses from the Hebrew perspective. It is a refutation is what I have here. Man, I put some 10-cent words in here. It is speaking out against the religion of the day. It is speaking out against the religion of works. And today we have our own religions that we have to worry about. There is the religion of works. I will tell you that most people, if you ask them how you get to heaven, one of the first things they'll start talking about is the things that they have done. Do you believe you're going to heaven? Why? And many people will begin saying, because I was a good person and I brought up my kids right, and because I, you know, gave to church, and because, hey, giving to church ain't a bad thing. Raising your kids right ain't a bad thing, but none of it gets you to heaven. We have religion of personalities. where if a particular personality says this or says that, then guess what? That must be the way it is. They must be right because they're a personality. We have people who have barely made it through high school. Some of them have gone through college to become actors, and these people are now telling us what the best medical decisions are for us. Think about that for, or political decisions. None of them were poli-sci majors. And yet we have elevated them to a point where they become their own religion. You have followers of particular celebrities. We have religion of ideas. Religion of ideas. Y'all need to be careful about the religion of ideas, because that is when you, without any scriptural backing, go, I think. You create a religion of your own. What does the Bible say about, and plug in the concern of the day, whether it be COVID, whether it be political, whether it be social, whatever it is. What does the Bible say about this? And people will often go, I think. Well, you don't have to think. You have the Bible. You can go in there and check it out and sort of know. And then stop there. I had someone send me an email the other day that said I needed to preach in a certain way. I needed to preach that the just shall live by faith. I said, I don't mind preaching, the just shall live by faith. And because the just are living by faith, it gave me this whole long rant. And I was like, well, the just can live by faith without all that extra stuff that you're throwing on top of it. Religion of ideas. And so I'm here to tell you, the gospel may be boring, but it is truth. And any day I will take truth over exciting. The gospel may have been said many, many times. 10,000 years, and we'll just be started. 10,000 years, we've just begun. The battle's over, and the victory is won. What? We have a song that says that we'll spend 10,000 years just uttering the gospel of Christ, and how we love to tell the story will be our theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. And yet, what stories do we tell today? If that's the story that we're going to spend all of eternity singing about, then shouldn't we get started now? I'm not saying that all religion is wrong. James chapter 1, verse 27, if you want to go over there, talks about pure religion and undefiled. It speaks about helping those who are in need. Is a religion that is pure and true. But we have this exhortation to remain true to the teachings that we've been given. We're then introduced to Christ as the Savior of all times. We're going to, by the way, all that was warm up for this. So hope y'all are ready. I'm ready. We're going to go over to verse 8 for a moment, where we have a simple statement. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. In the book of John, Christ is introduced as a concept of the Word. In the beginning was the Word. As in, at the very beginning of all time and all place was the Word. And we're told in the book of John that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld him as the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. John finished the concept in the book of Revelation, where he introduces us to the Word again, to Christ again, as the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. And now we see Christ, who is at the beginning of creation. Now, assuming the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, think of this for just a second. From the Apostle Paul's viewpoint, not from our standpoint, from our standpoint, we're like, when we look at Christ who was, or yesterday, when we look at Christ in that sense, that was the crucifixion. That was Christ who was resurrected. That was Christ who was buried. That was Christ who was alive and walking on the earth. Yet without sin, by the way, we need to add that in there. But understand, all of this happened before Paul put pen to paper in the book of Hebrews. All of that happened before Paul was ever converted to Christ. You see, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday for the Apostle Paul, is the same Jesus Christ that we're talking about today in the same time context, because Christ had already lived and died and been resurrected before the Apostle Paul was ever on the scene, just as with us. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, he has not changed. Jesus Christ, the same today, he remains the Savior of the world. Exactly what sin is it that sends you to hell? Absolutely. That's it. We talk about sin in this way. We talk about sin as if every little sin is what is going to either save us or keep us out of heaven. Every little sin is going to be it. That person certainly can't be saved. They've done too much wrong. They're a murderer or they're a thief or whatever they've been. And yet, the Bible teaches us something very interesting. The Bible says that Christ died for the sins of the entire world. He died for the sins of even those who would never accept him as Savior. He died for every sin that was out there. And when he was done, there was only one sin that remained, and that is the sin of unbelief. Once again, we have a dividing line. We have believers, we have non-believers. The believers will not always act like believers. Believers will not always do or say what is right. But they will still be going to heaven. There are unbelievers who sometimes will live lives that believers should be ashamed that they're not living. And yet their eternal destination is hell. Because the one thing that separates the lost from the saved is unbelief and nothing else. Jesus Christ, yesterday, today, he remains the Savior of the world. He has been the Savior of the world since the beginning of time, who remains the same forever going forward, so that he remains our Savior even in the halls of glory. He remains our high priest, which goes back to chapter 4, book of Hebrews. Book of Hebrews has so much in it. He remains our high priest, and he remains King of kings and Lord of lords. And that's not going to change. In the book of Matthew, we often quote the Great Commission. And most people, when they start quoting the Great Commission, I was so relieved and so, I won't say relieved is the wrong word, but I was so happy to hear the other day when Brother Bobby was preaching that he didn't cut this out. Many people, when they quote the Great Commission, say they quote it, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." But there's a word in there called therefore. And therefore means because of what has already been said, because of what you've already seen, because of that, go. And what had just been said, all power is given to me in heaven and in earth. Christ has dominion, authority, and power over all. He may not exercise it the way we want him to exercise it. He may not exercise it when we want him to exercise it. But he has a power and authority over all, and the day will come when everyone understands that. Lost and saved alike. So he remains and has been and will continue to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Down in verse 11, the high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place. Back in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 11, the high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. This is actually where the genesis of today's message started, and that is, where do we find Christ? I've already said that we don't find Christ in religion, because religion is basically just traditions piled on top of truth. If you want to find Christ, you have to go to the truth and sort of cut through the traditions that man tends to lay on top of it. Many years ago, I worked for the Roloff Evangelistic Enterprises. My job was to edit 20 and sometimes 30-year-old reel-to-reel sermons and to reproduce them in such a way that they could be broadcast out. It was an interesting job for the first 2, 3, 4 years. After the first 2, 3, 4 years, you've heard enough preaching from one preacher when you've done it 7 days a week. It really was a good time. There's this one story where the ladies up front received a phone call, and they said, "Tom, can you help this gentleman with a question?" And I said, "Sure, be glad to. I'll do what I can." They said he heard a song and he wasn't sure what it was. Well, one of my jobs as I was working through and doing all the editing and producing of these programs was to make note of any music in the program so that the correct copyright licenses would be fulfilled and stuff. And so that's what I did. I said, "I'd love to." And so I'm talking to the man and asked him what date, and he says, "I don't know, it was like last Tuesday or something," and he gave me a really vague date. "What can you tell me about the song?" He says, "It was amazing. I've never heard it before. It was talking about Calvary and going up to it and about Christ being there." I was like, "Calvary, Christ, cross. That could be any of a number of songs. Let me look back through my list of songs that we put out there." One thing Brother Olaf could do, he could bring words alive. And the song that he was looking for, I almost couldn't believe, because it's a song I've sung my entire life. "Up Calvary's mountain, one dreadful morn, walked Christ my Savior, weary and worn." And he said the chorus, "Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree. Wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, dying for me." And I said, "I know the song. It's called Blessed Redeemer." He says, "Where can I get sheet music?" I said, "You have a used bookstore in town." He says, "Yes." I said, "Go find a hymnal. Go find a good hymnal in a used bookstore, and it will be in there. Just look for Blessed Redeemer. Where can Christ be found? Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? He devote that sacred head for such," I'm sorry, Southern Baptist, "it's not a sinner, it's such a worm as I. At the cross is where we find Christ, and the cross is outside the gates. It's outside the camp. In the NIV, King James translates the same word gate. You get the idea. It's not in with the rest of society. It's sort of away from everything else. And this isn't talking about setting up a commune or anything like that. What this is talking about is that you're going to find Christ outside of where everyone else thinks he's going to be. People are going to think that you're going to find Christ in the synagogue. Jerusalem had a synagogue. Jerusalem had a huge church you could go to. And yet Christ was outside of that. Jerusalem had many places where people could go and speak and give their opinions and ideas on the steps of great buildings. And yet Christ wasn't found there. Christ wasn't found in the halls of Pontius Pilate, or at least he wasn't on this day. Where Christ was found was outside the city, and they talked about taking the sacrifices that are burned outside the city. What they're saying is Christ was to be found in the garbage dump outside of town where they put all the unclean things so that the city could remain pure. And Jesus became our sacrifice outside the camp. We are commanded to go outside the camp. Let us then go to him outside the camp. Reaching people for Christ is a personal mission. And I will tell you that inside our churches, we feel at home and we feel comforted and we feel like we're surrounded by brothers and sisters who understand us to some extent or believe the way that we do. But in order to go out and reach Christ, like the Bible says, you have to get outside of those comfortable places like the town. You have to go outside the camp. Reaching Christ happens as often as not, in fact, I believe more often than not, outside of church services like this. It happens when one person makes a connection with another person and shares a testimony. That's how we reach people outside the camp. And it sometimes comes with a loss of reputation, because there is danger in reaching people outside the camp. They may not agree with you. I told you earlier, there are lots of religions. There's even religions of personality within Christian circles. I heard that there was one particular misleader of Christian theology who got upset that his book wasn't on sale out in the foyer last week, and so he dumped over the table that was full of Bibles they were giving out for free. There's too much really bad symbolism in that. Dumping over the table full of God's word for free so that you can put your book out there for sale. You see, there are people who would look at the work that you do, people who will tell you when you approach them and talk to them about Christ and say that they don't believe that, they don't have time for that, and that you're wrong. And that's okay. Because you've done what you need to do for the Lord. And sometimes we just have to step back and let the Lord do the rest. We are commanded to go outside of the camp and to lead people to the cross that's outside of the camp. There is an ultimate goal. And we see this in verse 14. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for a city that is to come. Remember, I told you that chapter 13 was about tying things up. I've already said that chapter 13 sort of ties into Melchizedek. Chapter 13's already talked about Christ, yet without sin. that gets brought into chapter 13, and then he starts talking about the city that is to come, and we actually see that over in Hebrews chapter 11, the great faith chapter, where it gives the entire list, and it says, yet all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them far off, and were persuaded of them and embraced. Hebrews 11:16 says this, but now they desire a better country that is an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. Verse 14 is talking about the kingdom that is to come. The ultimate goal of every Christian life, not just to win people to Christ, but to live a godly life, a Christ-filled life, a life of reaching others for Christ here, and then to find our reward on the other side, which is in the kingdom of heaven. And if I didn't mention it for those who know me and who made it to the last sermon, yeah, there's a little bit of Kohaya in there too, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The ultimate goal is the kingdom of heaven. Sickness gone. And that includes COVID. Disease gone. Infirmity gone. Where the promise of fellowship in the garden with Adam and Eve is expanded to all of their descendants. And this is something that probably needs a little explanation. I've got like a minute and a half, but I'm going to tell it to you this way. In the book of Genesis, we are introduced to Adam and Eve, and they walked through the garden with God in the cool of the day, and they had fellowship directly with God, the creator of the universe, and that fellowship was broken by them. And what God has set forth in Christ is an opportunity for us to have that fellowship with the creator of the universe all over again. He is connecting not only back with Adam and Eve, but with all their descendants who will believe on them, and we will be a big family. Again, with God. And I hate to tell you this. We won't be a Baptist family. We won't be a country church family. We won't be a Presbyterian family or Pentecostal family or Catholic family. Because I told you, it's not about religion. It's about gospel. It's about the truth. That Jesus Christ came to this earth, was born, lived without sin, was born of a virgin, lived without sin. He died at the hands of men. And on the third day, he was resurrected and came back to life. And that all who believe on him, and that actually happened, all who accept him, accept the gift that he gives, they all get eternal life regardless of what tag they wear down here. And that is what we are commanded to spread, and how we're commanded to live, and what we're commanded to do. And as musicians get on up here, the question is, have you? Have you done what you need to do? Have you believed this? Does this remain just a fairy tale to you? You know, I like watching me a Disney film every now and then. But they're fairy tales. Sometimes they're fairy tales based on a little bit of history, but for the most part, they're fairy tales. They'll take one little action that someone did and they'll build an entire movie around the thing. And they're fun to watch. The fairy tales, they're not truth. Have you believed in this man named Jesus, who came and lived and died so that you can have fellowship with your entire back family that have believed all the way back to Adam and Eve, walk through the garden again in the kingdom of God. And if you have, what are you doing about it? As we sing.
Wandered far away from God, now I'm coming home. The paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming.
Thank you for being with us today, South Fork Country Church. For all those online who are joining us on the day or maybe month or year afterwards, thank you for watching and being a part. Brother Darrell.
Yes, sir.
I think we did pretty good as replacements today. I don't know. We'll find out.
I think we passed.
I think we passed, yeah. Got at least a good C plus on it, maybe. Well, you help bring the average up, okay?
I got
just
it.
To help with your brother. Thank you for being here today. We're going to have a close. I'll bring a closing prayer, and you
go
sing
far.
Us out of here. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've had to worship together. I pray now, Lord, that you will watch over us and guide us as your people. Keep in mind that we have a mission field that we have to serve in. It's our own life with our own family and our own friends and our own people around us. May we encourage them to godliness. May we show them the cross. May we bring them to Christ. And may we gather here, gather again, if you tarry your coming, to preach and to sing about the wonderful Savior who came for us all. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Love the time we spend with you. To share God's word and a song or two. May your blessings be many, your trials be few. And please come back next week.
Y'all have a great week. And hold that sermon to heart, because that's about as good a one as I've ever heard. Y'all have a great day.